The next speaker is Professor Robert Denk from University of Konstanz, and the title of his talk is Maximal Regularity and the Newton Polygon Approach. So please.
Thank you very much. Welcome everybody. I want to thank the organizers for giving me the possibility to give some talks here. I'm very happy to be in Japan again. Unfortunately, it's only an online version, but in fact, as you might see in the background here, this is in fact a Japanese lantern. So I was wrong, I asked my wife. So in fact, we bought this in Kyoto. So you see my home office is partly Japanese all the time. So I want to give some ideas about maximal regularity and the idea of the Newton polygon in connection with maximal regularity. But before I come to mathematics, let me tell some words about where I am from. So here you see a map of the four most important cities in Germany. Yeah? And of course, out of these four most important cities, Konstanz is most important because it's a very nice small town here. It's located directly at the border to Switzerland. And by the way, the second most important city in Germany is, of course, Munich because of FC Bayern München. Okay, and as I said, Konstanz is a small town, so the population is about 80,000, and it's located at the Lake Konstanz. And this is the largest lake in Germany, and it's a very beautiful lake, and it has a border to Austria, to Switzerland, and to Germany. And I also have here a picture of our university. So this is our campus, and it's a small university also, about 11,000 students, approximately 200 full professors. But it's within the German university, it was a little bit successful because it's already the third time one of these excellence universities, maybe you know about this competition, which took place in Germany since 15 years now. And we were successful in all three rounds until now. So what you can see here in the picture is, by the way, you have here the island of Mainau, which is a very famous flower island. You have, of course, here the Lake Konstanz, and you have here the university. So depending on the season and on the weather, you can decide either you want to watch some very beautiful flowers, or you go swimming in the lake, or you do mathematics. So this is the choice you have here in Konstanz. Okay, but maybe we should start with some mathematics. And my lectures will consist of three parts. So the first is maximal regularity idea, and in particular for parabolic boundary value problems. And here I will have a small overlap with the lecture of Yoshihiro Shibata, which we just heard now, but I guess this is not a disadvantage because this concept of maximal regularity, the idea of maximal regularity, of R-boundedness, is very important in this field. And in the second part, I will come to this Newton polygon approach, which is dedicated for some non-standard boundary value problems. And I will, in the end, I will go to some applications, in particular from fluid mechanics. Okay, so let me start with the idea of maximal regularity. And so I start with the idea of linearization, what we already heard now. So maximal regularity is an approach where you have a nonlinear equation, but you take the linearization to prove at least local existence of a solution for the nonlinear problem. And then I will come to the Fourier multiplier approach, which describes maximal regularity, which gives us a tool to prove maximal regularity. And then I will go into a little bit more detail into parabolic boundary value problems. Okay, let me start with an example. The example I want to consider here is the mean curvature flow. This is a geometric equation. And in fact, the methods I present and the methods of the whole workshop can be applied, of course, to fluid mechanics and many equations in fluid mechanics, as we already heard now, in particular, if you have a free boundary, but they can also be applied to geometric equations. This is also a typical situation where we have a parabolic equation and where we have an approach of maximal regularity. So the mean curvature is given by v equal minus h. And so v is the normal velocity. So you have a surface and the mean curvature flow behind describes the movement of the surface. And the law for the movement is that the normal velocity is given by the mean curvature, minus mean curvature, depending on your sign convention. So you can, I have here some examples. You can see here, so this is the time development. So here we have a large mean curvature. So it's a strong curvature and a positive mean curvature. And so the normal velocity is negative, so it shrinks. So bodies with positive mean curvature, so the mean curvature is the sum of the principal curvatures, bodies with positive mean curvature are going to shrink. And you can see here that this ring is becoming smaller and smaller. And here, of course, you have then some singularity. And here you can see a similar picture. So these parts here are more or less unchanged, and but you can see in this here we have again this shrinking. And you can also see that here we have a singularity again. So typically the solution of the mean curvature flow does not exist for all times. So typically they have some singularities, shrinking to a point or to something else. And what I'm presenting here, the idea of maximal regularity, is a short time solution. So what we want to show is a local in time well-postedness of the equation. So what we want to show in some sense is that for every initial surface, the mean curvature equation has a unique solution in some maximal existence interval. And the solution should be infinitely smooth in time and space for positive times. So in this equation, you cannot see that it's a parabolic equation, but in fact it is. And if we consider parabolic equations, then one would expect the smoothing properties. So of course the question is, what is every? So one aim of the maximal regularity approach is to describe a space for initial values where you have a solution. Of course, if the initial surface is already infinitely smooth, then you might expect that the solution is smooth again. But in the parabolic setting, you have, in fact, a smoothing property. So the initial surface is not necessarily smooth. And the question is, what is appropriate space for the initial surface? Okay, so this is in some sense the aim of the whole theory. And let me go a little bit more in detail. So if I'm still at this mean curvature flow example. So if we write this surface, at least locally, as the graph of a function. So this is the graphical situation. This is the graph of a function u. So if we describe the surface as the graph of a function u, then I can write formulas for the normal velocity and for the mean curvature. And if you do this, then you end up with this equation here. And you see here on the left-hand side, you have a very simple operator. It's dt minus Laplace, And here you can already see that it's a parabolic equation, yeah, because the heat equation is parabolic. And I have written the nonlinearities to the right-hand side. So this is the nonlinear part. And you can see here we have the second order derivatives here. And the coefficients of the second order derivative depend on the solution itself. Yeah? And this means that this is a quasi-linear equation. So it's linear in the highest order derivatives, but the coefficients of these highest order derivatives depend on the unknown solution itself. And this is a typical example of the of a quasi-linear parabolic differential equation. And for such equations, the idea of maximal regularity is very well suited. So one can solve semi-linear and quasi-linear equations in this way. Okay. So we are looking for this solution here. And if you write this down in a little bit more abstract way, then we have here the linear part, dtu minus au. And on the right-hand side, we have the nonlinear part, g of u. So a is now a linear operator. In our situation, it's simply the Laplacian. So in general, it's a differential operator. And g is a nonlinear operator. And I put everything which is linear to the left-hand side. And therefore, on the right-hand side, we have the value of g at zero. So I take the linearization of zero here, and the Fréchet derivative of g at the point zero is zero. And this is the setting where maximal regularity can start. Okay, so I repeat here again. We want to solve this quasi-linear equation here. And the idea of linearization, I already put all the linear parts to the left-hand side. So we consider for a fixed V. So we plug this fixed V to the right-hand side here. And for a fixed V, we solve the linear equation. And so we are now at the task of solving a linear boundary value problem or initial value problem. And so given some V, we obtain a solution U. And so this is everything is now reduced to a fixed point argument, yeah, because for if V equal U, we have a solution of the original problem. So the idea of maximal regularity is if we want to apply some kind of fixed point theorem or Banach's contraction mapping principle to this map, which maps V to U. Yeah? So I have V, I plug this V into the nonlinear part, and then I compute the solution U. So I get a fixed point iteration. And if we have this, then we get a unique solution of this equation. And in applications, you need something, you need a contraction. So something has to be small. And this means in the applications that typically the time interval is small, so you get a solution local in time, or the initial data are small. Yeah? So you need either small data or small time to apply this contraction mapping principle. Okay, and I'm a little bit cheating here, I have to say, because this was in the mean curvature flow, this was the linearization at u equals zero. And in general, we have a little bit more complicated equation. So we have an equation dtu minus a, which itself depends on u, is g of u. So if we linearize at not at zero but at some function, then this operator will also depend on u. And the linearization then gives dtu minus a of v, u equal g of v. Yeah? So this is now the linear part. But now the operator depends, of course, on this function v, where we linearize this equation, which means that this is, if we plug in this v, which depends on time and space, so then the operator is an a of t. Yeah? But nevertheless, the idea of maximum regularity works in the same way. For instance, if we consider a short time, solution, which is usually what we want to have, then we fix also t at t equals zero. Yeah? And so one can also consider maximal regularity if the operator itself is time dependent, but in my lecture here, I will omit this. So for simplicity, A is now a time independent operator, but the same methods hold also for time dependent operators. And then you need maximal regularity of A of T for every T, for every fixed T. Okay, so, but I, in my example, I have an operator which is independent of T, and therefore I continue in this way. So this is now the linearized problem. Now the right-hand side here is just a given function, yeah? And the initial value is u0. Yeah? So this f is simply g of v, and v is some function we plug in. Okay, and now we have a linear problem. And the general idea of maximal regularity is now we need some function spaces. Yeah? So this is just an equation, but now we need some function spaces. And so the idea is, and the task is in some sense, it has two components. Yeah? First of all, we want to find appropriate function spaces. So we need a function space for the solution, a function space for the right-hand side, and of course, a function space for the initial value. Yeah? So we need appropriate function spaces. And in the best case, this map, which maps u to the right-hand sides, is an isomorphism. Yeah? So we consider this equation as a map which maps u to this right-hand side. And then we want to have an isomorphism because then we have a continuous inverse, which gives us the solution. Yeah? So isomorphism means I can solve it and it's well posed because the by the closed graph theorem, the inverse will be continuous also. So the question is to find function spaces that this is an isomorphism. And maximal regularity has been applied many, many times. And typically, the typical applications are in the Hölder spaces, C alpha. So the basic space for F is a Hölder space with respect to time, or the LP Sobolev spaces. Yeah? And if you, I, in my talk, because this is what I am doing and this is the topic of this workshop, I will consider LP Sobolev spaces. And if you want to see something about maximal regularity in Hölder spaces, then see one can, for instance, there's a nice book, a book by Alexandra Lunardi. Yeah, and LP Sobolev spaces is what we will consider in the following. Okay, so the first task is to define appropriate function spaces, and this is not always trivial. The second task is to show that it's an isomorphism. Okay, and now I come to maximal LP regularity. Again, I have the same abstract Cauchy problem here. And now I start with an LP setting. Yeah? So the operator A is an abstract operator in some Banach space. Yeah? So A is a closed operator in some Banach space. And the right-hand side is a function of T in this abstract Cauchy problem, and it should have values in this basic space X. Yeah? So the natural space for the right-hand side is an LP function in time with values in X. And if we want to make this iteration, we have to plug in our solution u into the nonlinearity in the next step. If you think of an iteration process, which means that the solution should be as regular as possible. And this is the reason why it's called maximal regularity. So if the right-hand side in my equation is an LP, then we would like to have that. Then, of course, also the left-hand side is an LP. But what we would like to have is that also every part on the left-hand side is an LP. So DTU should be an LP, and AU should be an LP. Yeah? And this gives the natural or best possible space for maximal regularity. We have a Sobolev space of order one with respect to time. So this implies that DTU is an LP function. So WP1 is the standard Sobolev space, where the first derivative in the distributional sense is still in LP. And on the other hand, we would like to have that AU is in LP, which means that U should be in LP with values in D of A. And D of A is now endowed with a graph norm. And as A is a closed operator, D of A itself is a Banach space. So this is also a Banach space valued LP space. Okay, so this is the best possible space for our solution. A little bit more complicated is the question. So we know already now we know the space for the right hand side, and we know the space for U. But then we come to the question of the space of U of zero, of the initial data U zero. So once we know the space of U, this is already fixed now, then the space of U at the time t equals zero is given as a trace space. So in my talk, gamma t will always denote the time trace. So I take the value of some function u at time t equals zero. And then the abstract natural definition of the trace space is I take all u not in my space x, such that there exists some function u in the solution space, such that gamma t of u is equal to u zero. So gamma t of u is simply u of zero. So you have u of zero is u zero. So the trace space of my solution space is all values u of zero where u is in my E, in my space E. And of course the norm is also canonical. It's a quotient norm. You take the infimum of all norms of u such that u of zero is u zero. Okay, so this is the natural space, but this is not very helpful if you have a PDE and want to know what space this is. And then in many cases, the domain is, for instance, given as some Sobolev space of order k. And then some machinery, some theory is starting, which tells us what is this trace space and for time t equals zero. And it turns out it's a non-integer Besov space. So this is a Besov space. And in fact, this fact comes from interpolation theory. It's a real interpolation theory. So it is known that the initial values lie in the real interpolation space of X and the domain of A. So this is some ingredient which you usually use in maximal regularity approaches. Okay, and now we have all spaces, and now we can define maximal regularity. So in this situation, I define maximal regularity if this operator here, which maps U to the right-hand side, is an isomorphism in these spaces. And if this is the case, we have a solution operator. We have the inverse, because it's an isomorphism. We have the inverse, which is also continuous. Which maps the data to the right-hand side. So the solution operator applied to F and U0 is simply the solution of this equation. And now we know we have the solution operator if we have maximal LP regularity. And now, of course, we can go back to the fixed point argument, and we obtain a unique solution of the nonlinear equation using this fixed point contraction mapping principle. So some remark, if we want to show maximal regularity, we may assume that the initial data is zero. And this is because of the trace space. So we had gamma t of e. So this was u zero was in gamma t of e, was the trace space. Which means that there exists, it is the space of all initial values. So there exists some let's say U1. So there exists a U1 in E such that the value of U1 at time t equals zero is this given U0. And then we consider U minus U1. And then consider U minus U1. And then the difference of U and U1 has initial value zero. But of course, you will obtain something more on the right-hand side of the equation. So if you have then dtu plus au, then you have here additional terms. So we have minus dtu1 minus au1. But this doesn't matter. So you simply have another right-hand side in the interior for t equals zero, but then we will have here a zero. So we can assume, if we want to show maximum regularity, we can assume u0 equals zero. This will be advantages in the following. Okay, but now, of course, the original equation, the nonlinear equation, is now equivalent to the fixed point equation. Now, this was the idea. So if we have here u and here u, so if we can show that this is a contraction, so I formulated as a kind of theorem. So if the linear operator has maximum regularity, and if this map is a contraction, then the nonlinear equation has a unique solution for small times, and then in a maximal time interval. And the solution is, of course, a solution in the LP sense. So usually, to apply this, we need a condition on LP, on the index P of our LP space, because G of u has to be in the correct space. So we need G of u has to be an element of F. And this is usually guaranteed by some Sobolev embedding. And we also need some smallness condition, as I already mentioned. So this is the idea of maximal regularity. And if we apply this to the mean curvature flow, we have also seen just before in the talk of Yoshihiro Shibata, we have seen some examples of maximal regularity results. If we apply this to the mean curvature flow in the graphical situation, then you can see here we have some condition on P, which is needed for embeddings. The initial value is in some Besov space, because this was the real interpolation space. And we have a unique solution in the canonical parabolic solution space. It's in order one Sobolev space with respect to time, in order two Sobolev space with respect to x, because we have the Laplace operator. And this comes out of maximal regularity. And in our situation, maximal regularity of the Laplace operator. Okay, so this is a typical example of maximal regularity results. Now we come to the question how to prove maximal regularity. Now I consider the linear equation. So we want to prove maximal LP regularity for this linear problem. And as before, as I already said, we assume U0 equals zero. And this implies that we can extend both. So F is in LP with respect to time. So we extend F by zero. It's still in LP. And U is in the Sobolev space WP1. But u of zero is zero. Therefore, we can extend also u by zero. So we can extend both functions by zero to the whole line. Then we have an equation for t in R. And now we can apply Fourier transform. So we apply Fourier transform, so which maps t to the covariable tau. And the advantage of Fourier transform, of course, is that the time derivative becomes the multiplication with I tau. You can also see this as a Laplace transform, then you would write I tau equal lambda. This is more or less the same. So now we can Fourier transform the whole equation. And doing this, we obtain, instead of the time derivative, we obtain here I tau minus A. So this is now a resolvent equation. Think of I tau equal lambda running on the imaginary axis. So we have a resolvent equation, and of course now we can solve this. We can, assuming that the resolvent exists, we can simply apply the resolvent. And for maximal regularity, we need not only u in LP, but also the time derivative. But the time derivative of u, so this is in some sense u, yeah, so this is fu. And this corresponds to the time derivative, yeah, because time derivative means multiplication with I tau. Yeah. So for maximal regularity, if we want to prove that dt u is in LP, yeah, we remember we want to have u in the subalgebraic space of order one in time. So dt u is in LP, which means that this operator here should be a bounded operator in LP. Yeah? So I start with an LP right-hand side f, I take the Fourier transform in time, or Laplace transform, then I apply the resolvent, and then I multiply with lambda or IT. Yeah? So you have the usual notion of lambda times lambda minus A inverse. Yeah? So this should be a bounded operator in the vector-valued LP space LP in R with values in X. And with all these methods, we didn't lose anything, yeah, because the Fourier transform is an isomorphism, let's say in S prime or something like this. So it's even necessary, yeah. So we didn't lose anything. Yeah? The question is, of course, when is this a bounded operator? And the notion of this is LP Fourier multiplier. So I have here, note that I have here a vector value, operator valued symbol. Yeah? So our M was in our situation, M of lambda, say, was lambda times the resolvent. Yeah? And this is, of course, a bounded operator. So this is the function M maps lambda to a bounded operator, an operator in Lx. Yeah? So we have an operator valued symbol. Yeah? And I formulated the definition N, so this is one dimensional. So lambda is essentially I tau, it's one dimensional. I formulated this n dimensional. So if I have a function m which maps Rn to L of x, the set of all bounded linear operators in x, so this is an operator valued symbol, then m is called an LP Fourier multiplier if, let's say for smooth functions f, op m, so op m was defined, op m was defined as Fourier transform inverse, multiplication with m, or application of m and Fourier transform. Yeah? And this should be a bounded operator. So if for every good f, we have op m as an LP function, and we have an estimate of the LP norm. Yeah? So here the LP norm, here the LP norm. Yeah? Or equivalently, op m as a bounded linear operator in LP. So this is the definition of a Fourier multiplier. This is what we want to have. And in our example, we have to show that this symbol is a Fourier multiplier. This is exactly what we want to have. This is a Fourier multiplier. And of course, now we reduced in some sense the question of maximal regularity to the question of a Fourier multiplier, how to prove that something is a Fourier multiplier. And now I come to the definition, which was already given by Yoshihiro Shibata. So the question when something is a Fourier multiplier is not so easy to answer. Yeah? So I go back a little bit. So we have such operators. So we go this op m, all right, here, op m was essentially inverse Fourier transform, one or more dimensional, multiplication and Fourier transform. Yeah. And so the things are easy if we're in L2 and in a Hilbert space setting, because then we have the theorem of Plancherel, which says that the Fourier transform is isometric in L2. Even if it's vector valued, if we have not a Banach space but a Hilbert space. Yeah. And then a Fourier multiplier is simply an L-infinity function, yeah, because the multiplication with an L-infinity function is bounded. Yeah. In LP, it's much more complicated. Yeah. And in LP, there are classical theorems by Michlin, which tell us under some much more stronger conditions on M, we know that it's a Fourier multiplier. But these classical Michelin theorems from the 1960s that do not hold in the vector valued situation, but we have a vector valued situation. And therefore one has to improve the Michelin theorem. And this improvement uses a notion of R-boundedness, which was already introduced. So let me give the definition here. Yeah? So I have a family of operators. This should be a T. So my family T of bounded operators. And I call this family R bounded if there exists a constant. So I take here any operators out of my family, TJ, apply them to XJ. And then this factor is either plus or minus one. So I have epsilon J is either plus minus one. And then I take a linear combination of TJ, XJ, but I have arbitrary signs, plus minus one in front of it. And then I average over all combinations of plus minus one. And this should be bounded by a constant times exactly the same expression where here is no TJ. So the same combination of XJ. If you listen to the talk of Professor Shibata, and if you still listen to my talk, then you will see that the definition is a little bit different because he formulated his definition with the Rademacher functions, but the Rademacher functions are exactly this plus minus one valued functions. So this average means for the Rademacher function, you have an integral. I have here simply the sum. Okay, this is equivalent description. So this is R-bounded. And this is a complicated definition, which you never can check directly, almost never can check directly, but there are some theorems we will see immediately. And at least you can see if n is equal one. So this should hold for all n with the same constant. So if you take n equal one, then you have only one operator, let's say t, and then you have no sum here. And which means that, so here you have no sum, which means that this epsilon doesn't matter. So you have simply the norm of Tx. And this should be bounded by a constant times the norm of x. So this means for every t, for every t in my family, this means an R-bounded family is bounded with respect to operator norm. So R-bounded means bounded with respect to the norm in Lx as an bounded operator. So the family is bounded in operator norm. The operator norm of every operator can be bounded by a constant. And if you want to know a little bit an intuition what R-boundedness means, so essentially it's more or less boundedness plus a little bit more, but not too much more. In Hilbert spaces, it's equivalent. Okay. And this is the definition of, this is the condition we need in this famous theorem of Lutz Weiss. It's a variant of Michelin theorem, but it holds for an operator valued symbol. So the condition, so I have here a symbol which is n times continuously differentiable, operator valued with values in Lx. And now we have this Michelin condition. This Michelin condition essentially says, I take derivatives of my symbol, I multiply them with xi to beta, and I take for every xi and every beta, this is a bounded operator. So I have a family of bounded operators. Now xi runs in Rn except zero, and beta are all multi-indices which are either zero or one in every entry. And if this family of operators is not only bounded, which would be classical Michelin condition, but even R bounded, then it's a Fourier multiplier. Then this is a bounded operator. So this theorem was crucial for the development of maximal regularity results, because now we could check R boundedness and then we can apply Michelin and then we have maximal regularity. Okay, so R-bounded symbols lead to bounded operators. Now this is this famous theorem. Now we can, in some sense, summarize. So that's also due to Weiss. So if we have a Banach space of class HT, which is that the Hilbert transform is bounded. So this is holds for many reflexive spaces. Yeah. Holds for, I don't want to define it here, for many reflexive spaces. So this is the main restriction in application, is that it's reflexive. So P is usually not one and not infinity. And then the following statements are equivalent. We have maximal LP regularity. Equivalently, this symbol, what we had before, is a Fourier multiplier. Or equivalently, this set is R-bounded. Yeah. Okay, so this is the equivalence of 1 and 2. We already know, we're taking the Fourier transform. And the equivalence of 2 and 3 is due to this Michelin theorem. Okay, so this is the basis of checking maximal regularity in applications. And there's an even better version of Michelin theorem, which is due to Girardi and Weiss. And to explain why this is useful, I take a standard example. You take the heat equation, yeah, dT minus Laplace. Yeah? And you can take Fourier transform in T as we had. So you get I tau or lambda. But you can, of course, also make Fourier transform in X. Yeah? In the whole space, this becomes in Fourier transform xi squared. Yeah? So we have here now a function which depends, a symbol which depends on tau or lambda and xi. Yeah? And in the end, we want to apply the theorem before with respect to tau or the Laplace transform, but we have a symbol also in xi. Yeah? And the theorem of Girardi-Weiss says if we have the Michelin condition of R-bound in this R-bounded version with respect to xi, so now I have a famous, let's say this is lambda, lambda plus xi squared. So if the symbol in lambda and xi satisfies the condition of R-bounded, the R-bounded Michelin condition with respect to xi, we still have a family of operators with respect to lambda, but this is then automatically R-bounded. So if I need something more, so I need a little bit better Banach space with property alpha, which I also don't want to define, which is satisfied in many cases for applications. Now I have a family depending on lambda and on xi. And I have the same condition as before, but now also for all lambda. So I have an estimate on the R bound of all this. Then I get the associated operators, still a family, but this is R bounded. Not only every fixed operator with every fixed lambda is bounded by the theorem before, but this family, the complete family, is still R bounded. So I have R bounded symbols and R bounded operators. And this gives us the possibility to iterate. We first show that it's R bounded, that the condition is satisfied with respect to xi. Then automatically the condition is satisfied with respect to lambda. And the best message here is, if I start with a scalar valued symbol, as it is the case in the heat equation, so this symbol is complex valued. But the complex numbers are a Hilbert space. So R bounded in Hilbert spaces, R bounded is equivalent to bounded. So if we start with complex numbers or with a Hilbert space, then bounded symbols lead to R bounded operators. And the message of all this is that procedure, you simply have to check the classical Michelin condition. Yeah? If it's bounded, if you are in finite dimensional, start with a finite dimensional space, then by this theorem of Girardi-Weiss, the family with respect to lambda is R bounded, and then by the theorem of Weiss, it's maximal regularity. And this is the reason why you never check the definition of R boundedness directly, almost never. Okay, I have included one slide as an information for all people who like operator theory or semigroup theory. So what are good properties? What are good and bad operators? Yeah. So let me start with, in parabolic setting, with a sectorial operator. A sectorial operator means I have an estimate of the resolvent. Lambda times the resolvent is bounded in the half plane, complex plane, real lambda greater or equal to zero. And it is well known in semigroup theory that this is equivalent, that A generates an analytic semigroup. But now with this Weiss theorem, we have another equivalence. If this family of resolvents is not only bounded, but even are bounded, which is a little bit more than bounded, then in fact it has maximal LP regularity. Yeah? Of course, then maximal LP regularity implies that it generates an analytic semigroup. Yeah? And so you see that it's a parabolic theory, yeah? Because analytic semigroup means you have smoothening properties. But there are even two more properties of an operator which are even better. Yeah? So you can, if the operator has what is called a bounded imaginary powers, then this implies maximal regularity. And if even the operator admits a bounded edge infinity calculus, this implies BIP, bounded imaginary powers, and this implies again maximal regularity. So to show maximal regularity, you can either use this R boundedness, or you can use that the operator has bounded imaginary powers, if you know this by some way, or you can use a bounded edge infinity calculus. But the good thing is that maximal regularity is equivalent to R sectoriality, yeah? To this R boundedness of the resolvent. Yeah? So you never lose anything if you have, it has to have R bound, it has to be R sectorial if it has maximal regularity. Yeah? So this was this breakthrough in this theory. Okay. So now this was the concept and the method to show R boundedness, and now I want to apply this to parabolic boundary value problems in this simple situation. How can we show this? So now I have, I'm considering now a bounded, for simplicity, bounded smooth domain. P is in the reflexive range because only in the reflexive range we have this theorem of Weiss. And the domain is a bounded and sufficiently smooth domain. And I have a linear, because now I'm in the linear theory, I want to show maximal regularity for the linear operator. I have a linear partial differential operator of order 2m, say, which has some coefficients A alpha, and D alpha is the derivative. And I have here used a notation convention, which is very typical here. So this capital D is the partial derivative, but with some minus I. Yeah. And the reason, I guess, is obvious, because in the Fourier transform, we had, you remember, we had dt becomes I tor, and I want to avoid this complex I here. Okay, and I'm considering a boundary value problem, so I have boundary operators bj, so the operator is 2m, therefore I need m boundary operators, and they have a similar form here. So we have here a derivative, we have here the trace on the boundary, so the boundary operators take some derivative, takes the value of it on the boundary, and then multiplies with some function. So this is the trace on the boundary. Yeah, so we have in a parabolic problem, we have the trace gamma t, which was the trace on the for time. And we have gamma zero, which is in my talks, the trace on the boundary. Yeah. And we have coefficients, which are also sufficiently smooth, yeah, defined on the boundary. Okay, I assume that the order of the boundary operators is less than 2m. This is what is called a normal boundary operators. Yeah. And now I need some definition of parabolicity. So we need that it's parabolic. Yeah? So this was my operator again. And parabolicity in the classical definition, this is also appeared in the talk of Shibata. It's based on Akman, Akranovich, Wisik from the 1960s. So we do the following. So first of all, we omit every differential, every part of our differential operator which has order less than 2m. We take the highest order. And then we replace the derivative by xi. This is, of course, coming from the Fourier transform. So this gives the what is called the principal symbol. And think of dt as by Laplace transform, Fourier transform being replaced by lambda. So in Fourier transform and Laplace transform, our operator has this form. And the main condition is that this is now a scalar function. This function is never zero. No, this is not zero. No. For all x, of course, for all xi, and for all lambda with real lambda greater or equal to zero. No. And this is the condition of parabolicity or parameter ellipticity. This is a condition for the operator A. But we have also boundary operators, yeah? And this is more complicated. So we have, again, we define the principal symbol of the boundary operators in the same way. We have only top order. We have here xi. And now we take, we have here the boundary. Yeah? We have here some point. And we take the coordinates such that the inner normal is xn. Yeah? So we have here xn. And the tangential part is x prime. So x prime are the first n minus one. Okay, and we write, we fix this x, this point x, and we write our system in this way, for fixed x and for fixed xi. So what we do is we take partial Fourier transform here. So partial Fourier transform. Which means that x prime becomes xi prime. So the first n minus one. But we keep the normal direction. And then we get an ODE. We get an ODE. And we want to have a unique solution of this ODE. So this is the ODE we obtain here is this one. Okay. And now we are in basic calculus, I would say, basic analysis. We have to solve an ordinary differential equation with constant coefficients. Yeah? So how to solve this? Yeah? So we want to solve this equation here. Okay, so everything it has constant coefficients. So we are looking for the roots of the characteristic polynomial. So we consider this as a function of this tor. And we are looking for the stable solutions, and they are have the form essentially I to e to I tor xn, where the imaginary part of tor is positive. Well, this gives the exponentially decaying solutions. And if everything is parabolic, then we have an m-dimensional space of stable solutions. Of this equation without boundary conditions. And now we have m boundary conditions. So you see why we have m boundary conditions. We have now m boundary conditions. And so we factorize our given polynomial. So we take only the stable roots. So these tau j are the roots related to the stable solutions. And this is now a polynomial in tau of order m. And now the initial value problem is uniquely solvable if our boundary conditions, considered as a polynomial in tor, are linearly independent modulus this a plus. Okay. And so we write this modulo a plus, so we take the remainder class in the space of polynomials in tor. So this has order m. Therefore, the remainder classes have order up to m minus one. And we get some coefficients and linearly independence modulo a plus means that this matrix of coefficients is invertible. And this is called the Lopatinsky matrix. So I tell you this in a little bit very much detail because this Lopatinsky matrix will play an essential role in the second part of my talk. So in some sense, this Lopatinsky matrix describes the boundary operators in the space of all stable solutions. Now we can formulate the Shapiro-Lopatinsky condition. So the classical formulation is the following. So we assume already that the operator in the interior is parabolic. Then the boundary value problem is called parabolic if in local coordinates, this ODE we had before has for every right-hand side a unique solution, or equivalently for zero right-hand side only the trivial solution. So this has only the trivial stable solution. And as we have seen, equivalently, this determinant of the Lopatinsky matrix is not zero. This Lopatinsky matrix is invertible. So this gives us the description of this means, essentially, so if I have a strategy to solve this, this means locally on the boundary, I can take partial Fourier transform. I obtain an ODE. By this condition, I know it's uniquely solvable. So I solve this. And then I take inverse partial Fourier transform and get a solution of my problem, at least close to the boundary. Yeah? So this condition, this is the key step to solve boundary value problems. But this is what we will do next time. So I will stop here and thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you, Professor Denk, for your nice talk. Are there any questions or comments? So I have one question. And in the beginning of your talk, the aim of the local Lopatinsky is to find the solution which is infinitely smooth in time and space. And as far as I understood, you seek a solution in a maximal LP regularity class. How to show the smoothness of the solution?
Thank you very much. This is a very good question because your observation is, of course, completely right. So we define the spaces. We are looking for the solution in these spaces. So the solution space also for the nonlinear equation is exactly the maximal regularity space. And in fact, to show that it's infinitely smooth, this is an additional step. And usually this is done, which is called a parameter trick. Yeah. So at the end, you can show by introducing some parameter, which instead of this, for instance, of the time variable t, you take some alpha t. Yeah. And knowing that it has maximal regularity, you can, in the end, apply some kind of implicit function theorem to show that the solution depends on this parameter as smooth as the equation depends on the solution. This is by implicit function theorem. Yeah? So the smoothness in dependence of u of the equation, which was in the mean curvature flow, for instance, infinitely smooth. So u depends, the equation of the mean curvature flow depends infinitely smooth on u, gives by implicit function theorem, I solve this equation, gives the infinite smoothness with respect to the parameter and therefore infinite smoothness with respect to t. But as you observed correctly, this is an additional step. Yeah? So the first step is show for the nonlinear problem, unique solvability in the maximal regularity space. And in the second step, you show higher regularity.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for this nice question.
Thank you. Are there any questions or comments?
Maybe I have a small question. So you say that the Shapiro-Lopatinsky condition is just determinant zero. Shapiro, this determinant equal non-zero. But maybe you also assume that in order to construct a solution, you assume that the uniformity of this, uniformity means that this is estimated from Barrow, some constant, positive constant.
Yes, thank you very much. This is completely correct. And in my situation, I assumed a boundless domain. And therefore, the boundary is compact, and then you get this uniformity automatically.
Okay. I see.
But you're completely right. If you have a uniform C2 domain, which would be interesting, C2M domain, then you have to assume a uniform estimate here.
I see. But for example, Laplace operator with Neumann condition, then maybe this doesn't satisfy that this uniform Lopacinski condition or not?
It depending on the domain, of course. If you have the Laplace with Neumann condition, and if you have, then you need a uniform C2 domain, then you have this uniformity.
I see. Okay. Yep. Good. Yep. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Are there any questions or comments? If not the case, let's thank speaker again.
Thank you.